that were here from the beginning, you know who was here. My wife and I came, I believe, in the second year. Those who have, I'm sure that if you look around, you know who's here and who's not here. What have we done about that? We should be reaching out to them. We should be reaching out to them. You know, I know that that's one thing during my breaks at work, I do that. You know, people that I don't see at church, I call them and I bug them, for lack of better words. I just want them to know that, you know, Jesus still loves them and he hasn't forgotten them, you know what? So I just want to encourage us, you know what? Let's be about our Father's business, that, you know, that none should perish and none should fall by the wayside, that, you know what? That they be here in the house of the Lord. Amen? Amen. So, but I just want to, just if you would, I'd like our pastors to stand. Amen. You know, let's give them a, you know what? Let's give them a standing ovation. Come on now. Because they've endured. They've endured. They have endured, not only them, but their family. You know what? You think that it only, whatever they're going through only affects them. It affects their whole household. But they've endured. They've been pillars. They've been strong in the Lord. You know, they've been strong in the Lord. And it's because of people that are here in the house today who have supported them, not only financially, spiritually, but physically, have gone out of their way to make sure that they are taken care of. So, you know what? Let's give our pastors another round of applause. Amen. And then also give yourself a round of applause for being an encouragement and being faithful to what God has called you to be. Amen. So you may be seated. I just wanted to share that because, you know what? Throughout the last 18 months, it's been tough, hasn't it? Yeah. It's been tough, and we've seen the church go kind of like this with people coming in and going out, coming in and going out. And, you know, the pandemic is just another ploy to destroy the church. But what does the Bible say? The gates of hell shall not prevail against the church of God. You know, this is just something I'd like to share with you before I do the tithes and offering. And I apologize for going off. But in Matthew chapter 16, I believe, yeah, Matthew chapter 16, our Lord and Savior asked John the Baptist. No, I mean, he asked one of his disciples. He said to them, "But who do you say that I am? Is he still Jesus, the one who saved you? Is he still Jesus, the one that set us free? Is he still the one that delivered us? Has he changed or have we changed? Do we still give him the same time in the worship? Do we still worship and praise him? Do we? We know within ourselves, you know, if he's still the same God that saved us, or if he's more. But and there is evidence to that in our walk with the Lord. You know what? So I ask you, who do you say he is? Is he still number one? Got quiet in here. And that was not my intent to silence anyone, but to get us to look within ourselves and ask ourselves, is he number one? Amen, is he? So, with that being said, you know what? I just want you to know that, you know what? We're here Friday night for prayer. And there was a few, but the few that were here were the ones that God wanted to be here. But I encourage you, you know what? When there is an opportunity to gather as a community of believers, then we should do everything we can to come and be a part of that. And I understand some people have to work and whatever. I believe you, I understand. But you know what? If we randomly make excuses to not attend, what if our God was like us? If he responded to us the way we respond to him, what condition would we be in? We know. We know, church. And I tell you, because time is short. Time is short. And we need to get it right here. The word says he's coming for a bride that what? Spotless and without wrinkle. And I believe a lot of us have some wrinkles that we need to get ironed out. Amen? Amen. Amen. So I just want to, I hope I didn't spoil no one's appetite. I know you're still hungry. We're going to be, how many are hungry for the bread of life? You know, we're going to be served the bread of life today. Amen. You know, so our building fund, I just want to commend all those who have made a commitment to the building fund. The building fund is at $33,705. Amen. So let's continue to be faithful to that. Amen. Those who are giving to that, we thank you and we commend you, as you know what, and I believe that, you know what, the vision that was given to our pastor to have his own church building, I believe that's going to come to pass. But we need people to believe alongside him and support that vision, that dream. Amen, church? Amen. Does anyone need a tithing envelope? If you need a tithing envelope, please hold up your hands. The ushers will get you a tithing. And we're just going to read two scriptures. It's in Proverbs chapter 11, verses 24 and 25. And we have the basket here in the middle as we continue to do for our Thanksgiving gift cards. Amen. And like I said before, you know what? Half of whatever's raised here will be sent up north to our sister city, our sister church up in Hollister, amen. So I just encourage if you can, amen. If you're able to stand with me as we go to Proverbs chapter 11, verses 24 and 25. Are we there, church? The word of God says, there is one who scatters, yet increases more. And there is one with one who withholds more than is right, but it leads to poverty. The generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself. Amen. So in the essence, what it's saying is don't rob yourself of what God has for you. Don't rob yourself of what God has for you. Amen. So with that being said, let us come forth, bring our tithes and our offerings. Amen.
And let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide. The ransom for my life, oh, is my song. Yes, you are good. You're good. Oh, you are. You're good. Ooh, you are good. You're good. Oh, you are good. You're good.
Hallelujah. Let's stretch forth our hands as we lift up these baskets unto the Lord. Amen. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you for another day, my God. We thank you that you deemed us worthy for another day, that you breathed your Holy Spirit into us today, my God, that we may go forth and show your good works, Lord. We thank you for the ability to be able to sow a seed back into the kingdom, my God. Lord, we thank you, Lord. Use these tithes and these offerings for the furtherance of your kingdom, my God, that they may go to the highways and the byways, to those dark places, my God, to reach those who are lost and bound where we once were, my God. Lord, we thank you for your goodness, your grace, and your mercy, my God. We thank you that your love for us is unconditional, my God, that you never give up on us, my God. Lord, help us to have that same mindset with our brothers and sisters, my God. Lord, we thank you, my God. We thank you for the shepherd and his family, my God, for blessing us. For you are a God who blesses with the best, and you have blessed us with the best, my God. Lord, we thank you, and we give you praise, glory, and honor. And the church of God says, amen, amen. Let's give the Lord a clap offering. Amen. Hallelujah. Okay. Last thing I want to say, starting the 1st of October is Pastor Appreciation Month. So if you are pastors, if you want to starting the first, or even if you want to start today, if you want to show your appreciation for him and his wife, Pentecostal handshake, you know what? But I think the biggest thing that we can do is be there for them. Be the church that God has called us to be. Be the church that God has called us to be. We get good teachings here, very good teaching, the word. We don't get no peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. We get the meat here. So let's take that word that our pastor invests so much time in with the Lord and be good disciples, and be a light out there in that world that, you know what, people will say, man, what happened to so-and-so? He's no longer the same. No longer the same. And why? And why? Because of the word of God, which changes us, transforms us. So you know what? For me, I'm blessed, and I come, when he sends me a text, I come with expectations that I know that I need change. And I let my pastor know that I come with expectations. My heart, my mind, my soul, my ears are ready to receive what he has for me, because I don't, when I look at the mirror, I'm not happy looking at what I see, because I know that there's change that needs to be in my life. So I come with that attitude. Not change them. Change me. Change me. Amen. So let's give the Lord a big clap offering, amen, as we get ready to welcome our pastor up. Amen. Hold up. Hallelujah. Come on, let's welcome our pastor that comes up. Amen. Come on, give him a shout of praise. Come on now.
Try again. Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen. 7th year anniversary. Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen. It's been a blessing. Amen. And just a joy just for God to use people like us. Pastor Richard spoke of, imagine what condition you would be in, or we would be in. And he also closed it out with, we need change. All of us need change, and it goes, it harmonizes with the message, and that's why I know that it's confirmation with what the Lord has for us and what he wants us to grab a hold of and what he wants to do with our life. It's been a tremendous blessing in these 7 years, and we started off on in Rose Avenue. God opened the door. We got launched out in 2014, in August, and in September we were doing it in Rose Avenue in Channel Islands and Pastor Taylor's church. He went on to be with the Lord, and what a man of God. He had a heart of gold, and he allowed us to share the building with him, and guess what? They begin in Fifth Street, and he had a vision to have his own church. And when I went to the funeral service, one of the things that they mentioned was people laughed at him. They mocked him. And if you've been in the building in Rose Avenue, that's a beautiful, beautiful building. You know, and that was a vision that he had, and he spoke it to the people, and it became a living thing, and praise God for Pastor Taylor and for the people that he was surrounded with that loved him. And you just never know what God's going to do with your life. And we're a testimony. It's a blessing. And thank everyone that has partake. Even if you didn't start in the beginning, just continue to serve the Lord. And God is good. Amen. And let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Again, after, please join us afterward at Brother Abel's and Isenia's home. It's right, literally right around the corner. So if you didn't catch the address, get with them again, or follow somebody over there. Let's enjoy this time. It'll be a tremendous blessing. Hallelujah. Well, no further ado, let's open up our Bibles to the book of Acts. The book of Acts. Hallelujah. Book of Acts chapter 3 is probably behind me on the screen already. Let's give it up for the sound, man, the sound crew. Amen. They do a tremendous job. They work behind the scenes. And what an amazing worship team we had. Amen. You can feel the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Acts chapter 3, and I felt that God put this in my heart for this day, this special day, amen, that I know for a fact God is going to move. He's going to touch hearts. He's going to change lives, and that's what we expect, amen. We have to expect, amen, and sometimes in conjunction with the message, sometimes, thank God, we don't get what we expect. Amen. Many of you here, probably early in your Christian walk, you prayed for something that you thought it was God, and thank God he didn't give it to you. Amen. You know what I'm talking about. Praise the Lord. In Acts chapter 3, we're going to begin reading in verse 1. The Bible says, "Now Peter and John went up together to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. And a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple," which is called Beautiful, "to alms from those who entered the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked for alms. And fixing his eyes on them with John, Peter said, 'Look at us.' So he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, 'Silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk.'" Verse 7 says, "And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and his ankle bones received strength. So he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking, leaping, and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God." Verse 10 says, "Then they knew that it was he who had sat begging alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for your wonder, God. We thank you, Lord, for your great mercy, God. We know that you're a miracle-working God, Lord, and you will show up today, Father. We pray, God, that you would give us ears to hear, God. That you would clear our conscience. That the Holy Spirit would continue to move in this place, Lord. We stand in awe of your presence, Lord. Ready and willing, God, to receive whatever you have in us to deposit, God, or to remove. We ask you, Father, that you would mold us and shape us, Lord. Rearrange us. Have your way in our lives. We give you reverence in this place, God. We're careful to give you all the praise and all the glory is yours, and all the saints of God say amen and amen. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Thank you, Jesus. Verse 5 of the text, again he said, so he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. I said, it said he was expecting to receive something from them. What you're expecting may be beneath what's available. Have you ever thought about that? What you're really expecting may be beneath what's available. And that's what I got with this when I was reading the text. So don't sell yourself short. You don't know what you'll be missing. Sometimes you don't get what you expect. And sometimes if you don't get what you expect, it could be a disappointing situation. But today I want to come up with the flip side of a flip side of a philosophy. Sometimes not getting what you expect ain't a bad thing. Sometimes not getting what you expect can be a good thing. The Bible says the man in the text before us is a perfect example of this. He's a man that the Bible says that he had been begging daily at the gate. He had a chronic condition. But we are never told the man's name. But we are given many details about his situation or the condition that he was in. Pastor Richard said, what condition would we be in? We are told he's a certain man. That's what the Bible says in many of our texts. But we are told that he's lame. We are told everything about his condition, but we are not told his name. We are told that he was born with this condition. His feet don't work. We know that if we read the text, because we know that sometimes your name is not as important as your condition. Let me say that again. Sometimes your name is not important as your condition. They know everything that you're going through. Hello, somebody. Isn't it a terrible thing when people can't call on your name or don't remember your name, but when they mention that the problem that you're going through, they know exactly who you are. They don't know that your name's Freddie, but they know that you can't keep a job. They don't know that your name is Phyllis, but that you've been through 3 divorces. They don't know that your name is Bob, but that you're still living with your mom in her house. They're trying to remember your name, but as soon as you mention what somebody is going through, they know who you're talking about. We are told his condition. And watch this. In an ugly situation, he was at a beautiful gate. I said, are you hearing me? He's got great surroundings. But an ugly situation. And a jacked up life. There's somebody here or there's somebody watching. You got great surroundings. You got a beautiful gate. You got a great family. You got a nice home. You got a nice car. You got a beautiful gate around you. But you got an ugly situation. You ain't got no joy, you ain't got no peace. You don't have any smiles, maybe no happiness. I know I'm messing with somebody right now. Because you got the whole world thinking or fooled that you got it all together. Because you have a beautiful gate, the Bible says. But if they followed you home, and then when the light's out, they would find out that it's an ugly situation. I know I'm preaching to someone. The Bible said that he had an ugly situation at the beautiful gate. He's watching other people going or coming into the church. But he can't go in himself. He's in a bad situation and it isn't even his fault. He didn't ask to be crippled. He didn't ask to be born that way. He hadn't done anything to anybody to deserve this situation that he was in. It's one thing if I'm in a situation and it's my own fault, because I'm doing my own thing. The choices have put me in a miserable situation. But it's worse if you're catching hell and it's not your fault. And this is a situation we have here. It's worse when you're going through struggles and it's not even your fault. He's lame, and the Bible declares that he's been lame all his life. But at the end of the story, he's healed and walking. Hallelujah. Watch this. He's been lame all his life, but he gets lifted in 10 seconds. Oh, I think you missed that right there. His whole life is changed in about 10 seconds. That should be good news to somebody. And I'm here to tell you today that you may be going through stuff through your whole life. Situations. There may be situations that have been tough your whole life. But God's about to turn it around. I said, God's about to turn it around. Hopefully before the end of the day, God's going to touch you. Some of the stuff you've been dealing with is about to leave. Thank you, Jesus. It don't take God too long to do something. I'm here to testify of that. I'm here to talk to somebody. God's got so much power. He owns everything. How many know that if you've been dealing with something for years, God can deal with it in about 10 seconds. He'll turn it around in seconds. How many can testify that it didn't take God too long to turn your life around? It didn't take God a long time to turn things around in your life. I came here to tell somebody, the thing that has been keeping you down, God's going to turn it around today. I said, God's going to turn it around today. That thing that's been killing you, God's going to turn it around. But it's not going to be like you expect. The text said he looked at them expecting to receive something. He was expecting to receive one thing, but he got another thing. And what he got was better than he expected. Hallelujah. How many want something better than what you expect? Sometimes God won't meet your expectations because your expectations are too low. Come on, somebody. Sometimes God will overrule what you're asking because he wants to show you that he can do exceedingly abundantly more than what you could ever ask for. You just wanted a job, but you ended up the manager. That's what God can do in your life. Sometimes God will not give you what you expect because what you expect is too low. Come on, somebody. So watch what happens in this text. Aren't you glad this brother didn't get what he wanted? What he expected? This is what the Lord showed me in this passage. I don't care how long you've been in that chronic condition. It doesn't matter how long you've been in a situation that you're in. Your healing could take but a moment. That's what the text says. I don't care how long you've been stuck. Let's break it down. God can heal you in seconds. You're thinking here, maybe you missed your moment. The text says that he is laid at the gate daily, is what the text says, which means he's a familiar figure in the area. Everybody knew who he was. He's the one that couldn't get through the gate. But watch this. He's at the gate leading into the temple where every devout Jew would pass through twice a day. At 9 o'clock in the morning and at noon, and then they would pray at 6 o'clock when they got home. Every good Jew goes to prayer at the temple. But watch this. Jesus was a good Jew. And even at the last days of his life, the Bible says that he went to the temple. This ain't the first day he's at the gate. The text says he was at the gate every day. Are you with me? Jesus is a Jew who went to the temple, which means there were days where Jesus saw him. But he didn't get healed. There were days when Jesus entered in to the gate, but he didn't get healed by the Lord. Right there at the gate. And maybe right now he's given up. Because he heard that this Jesus who came now has ascended back. So he's saying, what am I going to do? Because he heard the Jesus who came to the temple that taught and delivered and he healed people was no longer available. So that now there was no hope for his healing. So I'll just keep begging for money. Because I missed him when he passed by. But the Bible says that Jesus had some representatives. Thank God for the representatives of Jesus who had power. And at the right time and at the right day, the man asked the right people. One amen. Because maybe the days that Jesus passed by, that he didn't ask Jesus for anything. Are you with me? But on this day, he asked the right people. I'm just reading the text. That's why you better be careful how you treat other people. Because they might be the representative that Jesus sends to bring your healings that you need deliverance from. I'm trying to make you understand that he may have missed, or thinking he may have missed the moment. Or you're here, you're thinking you may have missed your moment. You may be that somebody that's going through somebody that's taken a long time. And you thought you missed your moment. You've been to church and you've heard every message or every sermon. But I'm telling you, because you kept coming and you're faithful, your moment has arrived. I'm looking for someone that's sick and tired of being sick and tired. Always looking at somebody else being blessed. And saying, Lord, where's my blessing? I believe it's my turn. It just wasn't a waste of time. I'm not going to hate on you because it wasn't my time to be blessed. The devil didn't have a factor in it. God said it's not your time yet. But watch this. Here's why I'm glad he didn't get what he expected. Because he expected mercy and he got a miracle. Oh, you ain't hearing me in this place. You see, he expected mercy, a handout. But what he got, a miracle. How many know we serve a miracle working God? I'm glad he didn't get what he expected. Because if he got what he expected, he would have got mercy and not a miracle. He's holding up a cup and he's expecting that cup to be filled. He's asking for them to put money in the cup. He's looking at something that he's expecting to receive from them. But the problem is that no matter how much your cup gets filled, you're still going to be empty. He's still got a condition. No matter how many times your cup is going to be filled, you're still going to have that condition. The cup makes him happy, but only for a short time. The reason why you're schizophrenic emotionally is because you keep waiting for your cup to fill with happiness and emotion and external things. And as long as the cup is full and you're filled and you depend on everybody else to be nice to you, it helps you manage your misery. Are you hearing me? So there's a whole lot of people managing their misery instead of being delivered from their misery. Because you're trying to use external things to keep you happy and blind from the reality that what you really need in your life, it's called cup-filling Christianity. Are you chasing that? It makes you feel happy, but it ain't changing nobody's life. You're still the same. Your condition is still the same. We're looking for a church that makes us feel good. We don't need people filling our cups. We need to go where somewhere we're going to get changed. Where God does a work and He brings us out of the condition that they're in. Why should I come to a church and scream and yell, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, and you're still miserable inside? You're still mean. That don't just preach for cup filling. Oh, why can't we just get along, somebody said. This ain't no Rodney King thing. This is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. This is the great I am. We're trying to have people transformed and changed through the name of Jesus. The name that is above all names. That's what we want in this place. I'm preaching to someone that just says, I don't just want my cup filled. I want my condition changed. Glory to God. Because there are a lot of people who have filled cups, but broken conditions. Got a good suit on? Got your hair done? Maybe even all yours. Got a nice car, but you have a broken condition. He expected something for his cup, but they had something for his condition. Glory to God. I said, he expected something for his cup, but they had something for his condition. Is there anybody listening that says, I've had all the cups I need, but since I met Jesus, what a wonderful change in my life. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Peter said to the man, I don't have what you want, but I have what you need. There is a name. I said, there is a name. He said, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Peter said, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Because if you want your condition changed, Bethel can't change it. Your money can't change it. But there is somebody. And if you call on that name, the name that is above all names, there's power in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, the Bible said that demons have to flee. There's healing in the name. Anybody know there's salvation in the name of Jesus? Can anybody just call on his name? When you get in trouble, come on, somebody. Call on his name.
When you get in a situation you can't find yourself to get out of, call on his name. When the doctors give up on you, call on his name. When the prescription doesn't work anymore, call on his name. When the medicine can't help, call on his name. Your child may be on drugs, call on his name. Peter said, I ain't got no money, but I got a name. Are you with me? You got nothing but lead balls in your pocket? But you're fooling people that you're all that? Call on his name. Call on the name of Jesus. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. There's power. There's power in the name of Jesus, because the text says all they did was speak to him in the name of Jesus. Did you hear me? All they did was speak to him in the name, the matchless name of Jesus. And I'm almost ready to close because I know you want those tacos. And the trouble is with this man, and the trouble may be with you and I, that he was around a lot of dysfunctional people. I said he may have been around a lot of dysfunctional people, because the Bible says that he was at the gate daily, that people would pick him up and put him down. You have people in your life that way? That when things are going good, they'll pick you up. But when things are going bad, they'll put you down. And they'll kick you when you're down. The Bible says that he was at the gate daily. They laid him. They were enabling him. They were there, but they did do nothing for him. Are you with me? The Bible says in Acts chapter 3, and I'm getting ready to close. I believe God's moved. Now Peter and John went up together to the temple at the hour of prayer. How many know that prayer changes things? I mean, how many really, really know prayer as changes it? Not just, now I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. And that may be the volume. That may even be too much of a prayer for some of us in this place. Prayer changes things. These men were prepared. They were ambassadors. They were sold out for the Lord. What the Lord did for them, they wanted to do for other people. Has God put you in that condition where you have a heart condition like that? Because that's what it's going to take in these last days. And a certain man lame from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms from those who entered the temple. He went there to beg. He went there for different reasons. Maybe you come to church and you're coming for different reasons. Praise God for the representatives surrounding you. Praise God for the people who pray for you. Praise God for the people who would take the lead, to would guide you, who would guide you. The Bible says, who seen Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked for alms. Peter and John about to go into the temple, and fixing his eyes on him with John, Peter said, look at us. They got his attention. They knew what he wanted, but they also knew what they wanted to do. So he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk. Let's give the Lord a shout of praise. You got a lot of people and a lot of religions talking about you have no power. Who do you think you are? This text says otherwise. This text says that in the name of Jesus, when they prayed for this man, they took him by the hand and they said, get up and walk in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And guess what? The Bible says out of nowhere, he felt something. His legs were strengthened supernaturally. There's no condition that you're in and you're here, maybe you're watching or you're here today that you're in that Jesus can't reach. Maybe you're here or you're watching and you think you blew it. That you missed your time. But the Word of God says different. Pastor Richard said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. And the Word was with God. The Word was God. Jesus is the Word. He is God. And he's the same God today, yesterday, and forever. And he's still in the miracle working business. The Bible says in verse 7, and he took him by the right hand and he lifted him up. And immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. They just didn't pull him up and hope he stood up. The Bible said that immediately he felt something. He felt strength. He felt that he could do it. You see, when God touches you, you know it. He gives you the supernatural ability. He does a complete healing. The Bible says that he immediately, his feet and his ankle bones received strength. So he leaping up, it says, he stood up and he walked and he entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. Glory to God. Because when God really touches your life, I said, when God really touches your life, he transforms everything about you. He not only strengthens you outwardly, but he works from the inside out. And if you're here today, today may be your day. I said, you're here today. Today may be the day. Because the Bible goes on to say, and all the people saw him walking. You're here today, and you call on Jesus. And you have representative praying for you in the name of Jesus. And you get touched and you get healed. People are going to talk about you. People are going to see the difference. We just may hear about the testimony of people that see the change, but what about those that you never hear? There's a lot of people watching us that do not understand. But one thing they cannot deny, that it was Jesus. Let's all stand. Hallelujah. Verse 10 says that they knew that it was he who sat begging at the beautiful gate of the temple. They said, is that so and so? Yeah, that's so and so. I can't believe it. I can't believe it. It's got to be God. The Bible says that they were filled with wonder and amazement. Some of us are going to go home or to the place we're going, and somebody's going to say, something happened to you, man. You're not the same. Your walk is different. Your talk is different. You're praising God. The Bible says when they spoke and they said, silver and gold I have not. We don't have anything for you. But what we do have, we give it. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, heal. Get up and walk. Get up and walk. Before we change the order of the service, you're here today and you don't know the Lord. You're here today and you've never had a relationship with God. You may say, I know him. But we see passages in the Word of God where we hear that and it doesn't end well. I know him. To know someone, you have to spend time with them. They may have known about him, or they may know about him, but do you know him? Better yet, is he first? I'm not preaching on the streets, I'm preaching to the church. Is he first? I heard that today. You're here today and you want to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Right where you're at, lift your hands or just come on up. Say, I want to receive God. Come on up, brother. Come on up, Bronson Brown. Come on up. Come on up. The Bible says that you praise me with your lips, but your heart, it's far from me. But the Bible also says when you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus Christ from the dead, you'll be saved. Let's give a shout for those that are brave enough to come. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say, Jesus, I believe that you died on that cross, but 3 days later you rose again from the dead and you live forevermore. Come into my life. Take control. Wash me and cleanse me. Wash my sins. I don't want to be the same. I don't want to live the same. God, I hear your call. I'll follow you. Capture my heart. My heart is yours. You said that and believe that? The Bible says that all heaven rejoices. That the angels are throwing a bigger party than we're going to have tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You're here today. You need more of God. You're here today and you know that at the name of Jesus, you will bow. Every tongue shall confess and every name will bow. Every knee will bow. That's when it's all over. Are we going to wait till it's over? Or are we going to do it now? Are we going to confess now? Are we going to ask now? Do we want our miracle now? You're in this place. The altars are open. You need a miracle. You need a miracle. The Bible says that the name of Jesus, Christ of Nazareth, the man was healed. You're in a situation and you need Jesus. You need the Lord. Come on up. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You're here and you're a Christian. Stretch out your hand. You got to be praying. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Father, you know the heart. Examine the heart. In the name of Jesus, she's healed. You're healed, sis. Oh, hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, be healed. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, be healed. You're healed, sis. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Get ready, Rosenberg. Your life is about to be transformed. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, be healed. Be healed. There it is, right there. Don't fight it. Don't fight it. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, be healed. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, be healed. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.